We have an excellent speaker and historian. Edith Robbins has done a lot of research. And she's worked, you wrote the book, or you Edith helped translate a book about Civil War history. That's an excellent book. And she's done a lot of research with The Independent. So today she's going to give us a presentation about the history of the Grand Island Independent. And if you've been on any of our history tours, when we walk through the cemetery, we go by Maggie Mobley's grave, and Skip Meyer gives a big long speech about that. And he always talks about her as being his heroine or favorite person from the out there at the cemetery, which is really neat. So anyway, without any further ado, Edith.
Thank you. I hope I can follow up with this. Can do some justice to this nice introduction he gave me. By now you probably know I love newspapers. If you read the column Days Gone By, I just love newspapers. Do I talk loud enough? Is that loud enough? Okay. The other thing is that if you have a question and it comes to your mind when I speak, please let me know or interrupt me, because by the end of it, you may not remember the question anymore, so that happens to me all the time. I want to also mention that my family, the Robbins family, has been connected with the Independent for quite a long time. My husband in the 50s was a newspaper boy, and he would go downtown after school with his bike and pick up the paper, and Jean Buddy was the one who distributed the papers at that time. Jean Buddy, yeah. And in the 80s, my daughter became a newspaper girl in our neighborhood. And I still see her with this little red wagon throwing the papers in the front doors of the people. And during my daughter's time in the 80s, the paper changed from the afternoon paper or evening paper to a daytime paper, to a morning paper. And early in the morning, the bundles of the newspapers came by truck. And guess when my daughter was sick or it was too cold, who was delivering the papers? The Independent is now over 440 years old. It's a long time part of this community. It's one of the oldest papers still running in the state. And I want to talk today about the early times, the very early days of the paper. The first issue under the heading Platte Valley Independent appeared on the 2nd of July, 1870. Originally, the Platte Valley Independent was published in North Platte in 1869. We have talked about how the Union Pacific played a big role in the development and the economic development of this area. But without the newspaper, in our case, the Independent, the railroad could not have done it alone. The railroads and the local papers were the motivating force behind the settlement of this area. The newspaper was needed as an instrument to speed up this progress, and the editor expected to get rich by this progress. I want to put a somewhat romantic story to rest. I have read and also heard very often that our enterprising publishers in North Platte put their printing press on a Conestoga wagon and rattled down across the prairie to Grand Island. At first, I want to mention that the Union Pacific was finished in 1869 in Utah. And we had a timetable long before it was finished. It was a daily run to Grand Island. And so the other thing with the Platte Valley Independent, it was still published in North Platte the summer of 1870. So it's unlikely that the printing press from North Platte came by Conestoga wagon. I'd like to know, like to say something about the early publishers or proprietors of the Independent. The first one is Maggie Eberhardt and Zest Marbley. The newspaper's editor was Maggie Gerin Eberhardt Marbley. She was born in Limerick, Ireland in 1846. And she came over to America with her parents when she was just 3 years old. Eventually, the Gerings settled in Peoria, Illinois, and her father died a short time later. By the age of 16, Maggie was teaching. In 1867, at the age of 21, she came to Omaha, and where she married her first husband, an Alvin Eberhard. This marriage didn't last very long, and Maggie, however, kept the name Eberhard until her second marriage with Zess Marbley. She went to North Platte and was teaching there in 1869, and she started to publish the Platte Valley Independent, which is a nice name. It just includes everybody down, up and down the river. The following year, Maggie moved with the Platte Valley Independent to Grand Island. When you see old issues, the one from North Platte will say volume one and then the number. When you see the very first issue from Grand Island, you see volume two. That means both newspapers were simultaneously published at the same time, you know. And so anything with volume two and then continuing on is published in Grand Island. This stayed in North Platte for managing and editing the paper there. They probably thought they could do both papers, but it didn't work out that way. One should also mention that on the heading, Maggie's name always appears first, not his name, which was unusual for the time. Maggie and her paper must have struck a chord with the people of Grand Island, because only a week later, in the next issue, the Platte Valley Independent reported that our advent at Grand Island has been flattering. No community ever took a greater interest in any paper than the citizens of Grand Island. $940 were subscribed for advertising in one day. $180 was raised in less than 6 hours. This is a lot of money at the time. And it seems to be obvious to me that Grand Island needed a paper. I don't know how much Zess was really involved in the paper or in the writing. He probably took more care of the business side. In the papers out of town, it is always stated that Maggie is mentioned who runs the paper. It's not him so much. Zess was supposed to be a good-looking guy and a real ladies' man. He also was once seen at a ball at the Liederkranz with a lady who had a mask on. And nobody knew who she was. And I think Zess lost his membership of the Liederkranz for that reason. Silly. I think also another incident shows how Maggie was in charge. In 1874, there was an editor here of a paper which was called The Mirror. And this was a temperance paper. In his paper, he had made some not very flattering remarks about Maggie. And the story goes that she took a whip and let him have it in public. So she was strong. One little note, maybe on the side here, because of the large German population, she saw the need to have a paper in the German language, and that was the Nebraska Staatszeitung. It lasted a very short time only. It would take another 10 years before Grand Island had a German paper. There's a little note in the Nebraska Advertiser, not here in town, but on the east, where it says, Zess Marbley and Maggie Eberhard, who have for some time been associated as editors of the Grand Island Independent, and on last Sunday entered in partnership at Omaha as man and wife. So they got married in December of 1871. So how does it look? The first issue of the Platte Valley Independent, as we know, is dated July 2nd. And Maggie was the editor. And it says, with an office in the two-story brown frame building near the depot. So that was their first office, close to the old depot. How did the paper look like? Well, it was a weekly. It came out every Saturday. And the front page on top, the heading was Platte Valley Independent, a weekly journal devoted to the interest of Hall and Merrick counties. Now, why did they put Merrick County on it? Because the Independent secured the publication of legal notes of Merrick County. And that would provide some extra revenue, which was very important then as it is now. The paper, the front page, was white and it had six columns, and it was 4 pages thick, the very early ones. The front pages mostly had advertising. The second page had information and advice about farming, or stock raising in the Platte Valley was one of the articles. What crop you can grow, I mean, this was very important for newcomers, for farmers who did not know, and they came from a different climate, what to do. The third page often brought local matters and also a lot of advertising. I mean, the people needed, the independent needed the advertising. The Union Pacific, for example, had an ad which it pointed out it ran daily a train from Omaha to Sacramento in 4 days, probably a dizzying speed, I don't know, 4 days. And also it brought on the third page often information about prospective available land, you know, for immigrants who came here. Its key focus of the Independent was not politics or so, it was the promotion of this area. You hardly found political or international news. This was, as one could read, a good place for poor men. So if you didn't have money, you came here, you could make it big. Land was available, and every issue also contained a map which showed still land to be able to get, you know, in this county. It was a county map. For years, also, every issue would contain some wonderful puff. Advertising a place is called puff in the business of newspapers. And 1874, there is an example, Grand Island today is the very best business town of its size in the state. Is that too loud? Should I wait until that is by? It says, Grand Island today is the very best business town of its size in the state. And it is growing at a rate that unmistakably proves that it soon will become the largest city in Nebraska. Another one is the liveliest little town on the Union Pacific Road is Grand Island. Its people are live and energetic businessmen, and through labor, Grand Island is making rapid progress toward being one of the best business points on the road. Well, if you live here, you know that, but why would they print that? And it is because papers were sent to the east to get people to come here. I would like to make a short note on Maggie Marbley still. She had in the 90s a divorce from this. She was for a short time, and we don't know how long, institutionalized in Lincoln. This was long after she had sold the paper. The paper was sold in 1883, and this is here in the 90s. My theory is, and I cannot prove it, but I wish I could, there was in New York Nellie Bly, and you all had that probably in school, heard about Nellie Bly, who went on her own to be admitted to the insane asylum in New York. And this was a sensation after she reported how the conditions are. Maggie was only, I don't know if she did it, if she was really admitted, but 2 years later, after this Nellie Bly incident, she winds up in Lincoln in the insane asylum. And she is there for a short time, as I said, after her. She spends most of her life writing about the terrible conditions, the ill treatment she suffered. And there's an article, Life in a Madhouse, which is based on Mrs. Nellie Bly's experience. She dies on February 10th in 1907 at the age of 61. So I don't know, I could never prove that. I went to the courthouse to find if there are records, because the county has to admit somebody to the insane asylum, and you need several people, like a lawyer and a doctor and so on. I was told that records on mental problems will never be published or never be opened, so I can never find out what really happened to her. I wish I could. So the survival of a weekly paper was tied to the population goals. You know, you needed to have a viable city. And the paper would solicit advertising from the local stores, sometimes being paid with merchandise. Here's a cute one. Persons knowing themselves indebted to this office will oblige to us by coming forward with their greenbacks as soon as practicable. Now, it could be money for a subscription. It was 10 cents a week, a paper wasn't very big money, but it, probably the advertising, you know, that they paid. And it says here, those who do not find it convenient to pay in greenbacks can bring wood, corn, potatoes, chickens, butter, eggs, or anything else that printers can use to dispose of. I think that's cute.
What year was that?
That is of the beginning, 1870, let's see, 70, okay. 70, 71. As a return, plaques in the news column appeared praising the bargain rates of this business or elegant supply. Running a paper was always a very tough business, and I think it's still today when I have looked into a little bit of these things. Because of a paper's potential for success, it was not, there was a potential, as I said, when a city grew, the readership grew, and you could make money, probably. So it was not uncommon that a town would have several papers. And the second paper had arrived in Grand Island, and competition became fierce. Maggie Barbley did not hesitate to print in the Independent the following attack, and this is my all-time favorite. I love this one. Parents of Grand Island, businessmen of Grand Island, decent people of Grand Island, how long will you tolerate in your midst such a nest of reeking filths as the Grand Island Times? Ask yourself if you want your wife, your sister, or your children to feed upon such charking and poisonous obscenity, which is a disgrace to the city, a disgrace to journalism, and absolutely ruinous to homes. Couldn't print that anymore today. I found another interesting note from 1871. The Independent has now a paying circulation of 500 copies. In addition to this, from 200 to 300 copies are distributed gratuitously throughout the East. Advertisers will do well to remember that. So she reminds the people, if you advertise on our paper, it's not just right here in this area, but also in the East. So when you think about 500 papers, in 1870, we have Hall County. Grand Island is not incorporated yet. It comes in 1871 when it's incorporated. So we have a census of about 1,057 people. This is the whole county. So 500 papers is quite wonderful. In this, of these 1,057 people, there are 46% Germans. Probably many can read English to begin with. There are 32% Americans. 44% of these total of 1,057 are minors, that means under the age of 21. So 500 papers, that's not bad, you know, for readership. And to be fair, we know that the Independent also was read in Merrick County. But we always have to think about, you know, the farmers we may outside, I don't know, I mean, you had to have English readers, you couldn't do it with German ones. So 200 or 300 papers which went to the East, she writes, and many most likely would wind up in New York at Castle Garden. Castle Garden was in New York as a receiving station for immigrants who came by boat. That was on the tip of Manhattan. Today it's a nice lovely park, but that was Castle Garden, that was, you know, long before. The state of Nebraska placed, like other states did there too, placed an immigrant agent at that place. So it's most likely that he took some papers from here. It is, you know, if you would move to another place, you probably would try to find the papers of that town too. I would subscribe maybe for half a year before I move to the paper, of the local paper of that place. So. And I also, again, want to mention that each of these issues contained a map of what land is available, and that was a big draw. Land for all the people who would like to come. The state of Nebraska in 1870 had sent up an office. It was called State Immigration Office in Omaha. And it appointed agents for the East, of course, for Castle Garden, and but also for different countries in Germany. And in 1871, our Fred Hedde, and you know all about Fred Hedde, became the state Nebraska state agent over there in Germany. There were problems from the beginning, since the whole thing was way underfunded. The state didn't think there was too much gained by that. So when Hedde returned from Germany, he gave a long report to the immigration board in Omaha. This is a nice report, and you know, one day somebody should publish that. That's a very good one. He was highly critical about the procedure, how immigrants were brought over here. On the other hand, the Swedish agent from Nebraska said, due to his effort, that thousands and thousands had arrived in Nebraska. So the Independent didn't think so. They wrote, "In Hull County, we have yet to meet the first individual who will acknowledge that he was brought here through any efforts made by the State Immigration Board, while we find that fully half of the new settlers readily admit that they were induced to come to this county through the instrumentality of the Independent. The first and the greatest cause of attracting immigration is a local paper, which is sent throughout the East by publishers and friends." So that's something to hold on to, I mean, newspaper. Another thing the Independent really did very well was railroad promotion. I think that people still hoped that Nebraska's capital eventually would move here in the middle of Nebraska. Some even believed strongly and vehemently that the United States capital would move here. And why not? I mean, anyway, we're in the middle of the country. Some railroads meeting at one point would be a key to attract a very attractive place for the capital. You know, if you had several railroads here, not just the Union Pacific. And the Independent fought, there is no other word for it, they fought to have a connection here with the Union Pacific. I like to compare this with the efforts of the Independent has put forward to get the state fair here. I mean, they really were behind that too. There is a little note here, the Hall County will give the Burlington and Missouri River Railroad $100,000 to make this their point for connecting with the Union Pacific instead of running to Kearney. So $100,000, think about this, is 1871, 72, unbelievable amount of money. They offer even a piece of land. The Monsieur König und Wiebe, this was a store here in town, offer a quarter of a mile, offer 40 acres, about a quarter of a mile north of the Union Depot for depot buildings. I don't know, I should go to the Register of Deed and find out who owns this piece of land here before. I don't know, I have to figure this out one day when I have time. The Independent also pointed out in their articles that many more people would be happy to donate land in order to get the Burlington, Missouri Railroad here. I have looked at a map of 1882, and you can see the railroad coming down from Omaha to Lincoln, and then going to Hastings and to Kearney. So the connection was in Kearney. At that time, before that happened, of course the Independent was very convinced that it will arrive here, not in Kearney. There was big competition there. The Independent writes, "We conversed with several prominent men of the Burlington, Missouri Railroad who seemed to think that our offer," this is the $100,000, "to that road to make this point their junction, and that it is very probable that we will secure the road. This will be a terrible blow to the future capital of the United States," and I have to explain this one. In Kearney was a guy, he's very interesting, his name was Moses Sydenham, and he had started a newspaper called the Central Star in Kearney. And he was bragging about and very convincing that Kearney would be the capital of the United States. So the Independent says, if we secure the railroad, then we may have a chance to become the capital of the United States. Another thing, Mr. Sydenham is a story. I mean, I could talk about him another program here. The Union Pacific Rail Sharps arrived here, which was really the first major industry in Grand Island. Grand Island, it writes here, is excited, they're very excited about this. Grand Island is on the high road to prosperity. As a center of an agricultural region unsurpassed by any part of the great state of Nebraska, she has rapidly progressed to the position of a thriving city. But now, this is now about the Sharps, the Union Pacific Railroad Sharps come here, but now she is to darn her clothes as a manufacturing town. The new railroad Sharps have begun to loom. It's kind of a nice thing. In 1883, Maggie and Zess sold the newspaper, the Platte Valley Independent, to Fred Hedde, who turned the paper into a daily. From then on, we have a daily paper. I have not much information because all the early dailies from the Grand Island Independent are missing. We don't have that. But we know from that day on, we have a daily paper. Yes?
Going back to your comment about for a while, they had the paper, and you said it didn't last very long. Could you go into that a little bit? Do you know anything about it?
Yeah, there were a lot of Germans, as we know here, but it required at least a lot of money. The Staatszeitung was a beginning from one paper, the Independent. The Grand Island Times, that reeking filth we just talked about, also started a German paper. And first two couldn't survive, that's for sure. Somebody merged the two later, and they didn't survive either. What you needed with the German paper, you had more difficult lettering. I don't know if you have seen old written things. It's more difficult. So you needed, at first, somebody who could buy the letters and the whole printing stuff. And then you needed also somebody who could set the papers. You know, somebody who was very good in doing business, it was expensive. So I don't think, the first paper came, the German paper was called the Herald, and that was 10 years later after all these tryouts. So, interesting. let's look in the 1880s, the city of Grand Island, how it looks like. We have now a census which separates the city from the county. We have to mention that one. Grand Island by 1880 has 2,900 people, of which 65% are Americans. So you have a much better, stable, much more stable base for readership. The Germans were, as I said, only 21%. In the county, we have 5,600 people. And of course, many more Germans, because the Germans came here for farmland and they were sitting outside, not in the city proper. So we have, I remember somehow the Washington Township had 70 or 80 or 90% Germans, so it was almost all German. So that, the newspaper later, the Herald, reflects that also. You have a much more, less politics, more local stuff in the German papers. The interesting is also that now you see in the Independent a shift from promoting this area to more politics, more, you know, less promoting, because we have enough people here now to survive. And as I said, we have the German paper comes out in 1886, I think it's called Der Herald, which is democratic, and the Independent is Republican, so it's kind of interesting to read these two about local politics. Interesting. A little bit about Fred Hedde, our proprietor. He was born in Holstein in Germany from a well-to-do family, and he was a lawyer. This is a photo when he was in Germany. I got this from German. He's a very young man here. I like the glasses he had. So he was a lawyer. He participated in the 1848 revolution, which was a revolution against Denmark. When you look at Stolle's book in the prefix written by his sons, they're talking about that the revolution was against Prussia. This was not the case. It was against Denmark, because Denmark wanted to take over Holstein. Hedde at that point is also a newspaper. He runs a newspaper. It's called the Kieler in Kiel Correspondenzblatt. It's a very progressive democratic paper. He is also a member of the Holstein government and is criticized by Karl Marx, of all people, that he's a bourgeois, which I thought was interesting. So when he comes to Nebraska and Grand Island, he was a very well-educated man. You know, he was after the revolution, he loses his license as a lawyer in Germany, and so he has no reason anymore to stay. He can't work. And he comes to the United States. In Davenport, he writes many articles for local papers. In 1857, he is, since he is familiar with all the landlords, he had a real estate business in Davenport. He comes with his group here to start Grand Island, or the area here. He also is a member of the territorial legislature in Omaha for quite a while. He becomes a state immigration agent in Germany. And in 1882 or so, he starts a newspaper here in Grand Island. It's called The Anti-Monopolist. It's against the railroad monopoly. Remember, on the beginning, the railroad, Union Pacific, was our friend. They gave us land here. The land where the Liederkranz is honored was donated by, they wanted a community here. But they needed people to live here in order to pay freight rates. That was a big thing, you know. If you have people living there, they need to transport their crop, and so that was the reason. But now, since the Union Pacific is the only railroad here in this area, they have a monopoly on the freight rates. And that's where Hedde gets iffy about it. He thinks, you know, our people here are being exploited by the railroad, and that's why he started this newspaper. He then buys the Independent in 1883. So about a little bit of politics, what Hedde is all about. He is a very good writer to begin with, and remember, it's not his mother tongue. You know, he writes in English now, but it's very, very interesting. In the 80s, we have a temperance, the election's always around temperance. Prohibition amendment is adopted, and that is called the Slocum Law in 1882. It's interesting because that law was against alcohol in general. It was run by a Republican Party, but it provided, you could have a saloon, but you would have to buy a license for $500, which was an incredible amount of money. If you went to Omaha, it was much more. It depends on the size of the city, but for Grand Island, it was $500. And so many of the saloons had to close. The Liederkranz is interesting, they got around this. The Liederkranz was an open place. You could go there and participate in dances. It was not a closed society. And at that point, the Liederkranz decides they want to be a private club. And so the doors are closed for everybody, and they don't have to pay the $500. That's the way they got around it. It's not a public place anymore. Hedde writes something interesting. He says, there is no doubt that that illiberal Slocum Law is a result of the work of women and of men of feminine turn of mind. If the ladies will do good work, let them abstain from political aspirations. This sample of female lawmaking shows that their minds are not wide and their sight not far-seeing enough to understand life as it is. The guy was married twice, by the way. Germans in this area are, of course, against this because they want their beer on Sunday. And as I said, you needed this $500 license. So as Hedde was caught in between, he is a Republican, and Independent was Republican, he was supposed to be for prohibition. But of course he wasn't. And it was similar with women's vote. He did not think women should vote, despite that the Republican Party thought, Democrats not. Remember, maybe from last time I spoke to you, that we talked about a correspondence between Hedde and the suffragette Harriet Brooks from Omaha. There was a, remember that, yeah, that was very interesting. So Hedde thought that women did not have the brains to do all that. He even pointed out to some biological problems women have. He writes here, the introduction of women into political life would only lead to excite their ambition, like that. They would try to be governors, congressmen, and presidents, and would undertake a brain work beyond their mental power. So he didn't think very much of us. He also supported strongly the separation of church and state. He had not much against even prostitution in town, because he thought that would kind of get the business going in a city. He says, it requires men of broad and liberal views to build up the various industries of a prosperous city. Fanaticism never built up any city, though it has resulted in the destruction of many. So that was his contribution to church and state. Hedde always encouraged the economic growth of Grand Island, and the Independent supported the construction of the sugar beet factory, which came, oh, we saw today a headline of the sugar beet factory, I think, which the sugar beet factory brought many jobs to Grand Island. And then the development of the cattle and horse auctions, or the horse trade here in town, that was a big thing too. He never hesitated to make his views known. Even later, when he was over 80 years old, he still writes in this sharp and precise way or style. And this is amazing to me. Since I have read some of his writings in German in the old papers, his style has not changed very much in all these years. Hedde dies in 1908. The Independent had a tough time during World War I. We have A.F. Beechler, who's a publisher and editor of this time, but he's of German, he's a German. And so the Independent one day finds his doors, its doors are painted yellow, the color of traitors at the time. The paper must have sailed through the dirty 30s with not too much damage. It is still alive today, very much part of this community and of the Midwest. So thank you. I have here a few issues of the 140th anniversary paper. You can take one. So I hope you have some questions for me. Has anybody experienced, was anybody a paper boy?
I think you covered it very well, Edith. You gave a good report.
Thank you. Yeah, of course. Yeah, and today, you know, when it's so dark outside, my husband and I did most of the paperwork for my daughter, and then we gave up the paper. It's just, I mean, I'm amazed every morning at 5 o'clock somebody throws a paper in my door. It's amazing. Yeah.
When Grand Hedde built the Hedde Building, Third and Locust.
Yes. No, that all these type of buildings were business enterprises. You rented to doctors, you rented the shops down there. The Independent itself was in the basement. He lived there, I don't know, it was built in 1886, so he lived there for quite a while. His wife, it was first shorter than it is now, and his wife, after he passed away, built that next wing to the down on Locust Street. You know, you can see there is this corner and then that. The Independent, I don't know, old photos, you can see there is kind of a flag mast on top, on the middle, on the corner. Once in a while, they would put up flags to show what the weather will be. There was a weather prognosis. I don't know, black flag was bad weather. And I don't know the terminology about this exactly. And if you want to see old machinery at the Stuhr Museum, I think the Independent donated most of the machinery on the printing presses and whatever is out there. Came from the Independent originally. At the time, or 30 years ago probably, there was still a guy around who could set a newspaper with letters. You know, today this is all electronically and computerized. But at the time, you put a letter and put it on the page, and it was upside down, you know. And this guy could still do this blind. He would know exactly where all the letters were. You just go like that. You had to set a page for, you know. That was amazing. Yeah?
So was the Independent always totally printed in Grand Island? Did we ever have a newspaper that came to front and back printed and filled in the inside?
The other way around. The front page was printed here. Some of the stuff was printed somewhere else. Yeah, yes, it existed. But the name, the Independent, and so was always in Grand Island.
So the center part?
There could be a story, a novel. Certainly in the German paper, there was some news. You know, the Herald had quite a bit of nice novels for the ladies to read on certain days. Had you any stories to tell me about the Independent? Maybe somebody works there for you. Yeah?
I was looking through a childhood scrapbook, which for me was the 50s, and to me it was a great newspaper. And they would periodically go to the elementary schools in town and do articles about what was going on. So I had clipped articles that were about my school, which was Trinity Lutheran.
Okay.
And they would just take pictures and talk about what we were doing.
Yeah. Well, I think there is a tendency, I think some teachers use the paper too.
Yes, but yeah. They had copy proofreaders back in those days, plus the writers were not dependent upon spell check and all those other things.
Yeah.
Well,
the Independent reads at their office, they have proofreaders, so everything is read at least twice before it is printed today. So, there is, this is a special issue which was produced for the 140th anniversary last year. And you have, here is Dan Smith, who is a publisher of the Independent. And then it's a little article how it came to pass. But interesting are the different headlines, how the story about how everybody delivered the paper. Something about newspaper boys, which I enjoyed. Let's see. In the middle, things of the past. Here's the Hedda building. There's a blackboard here in the middle. And here's a picture of Maggie Marbley, another one. She's on the front page here, there, and Fred Hedda. And let's see. This is when we had the tornado, how the Independent reported that. I'm trying to find this picture of the newspaper boys. One here. Oh, here. There is a room, and I think, I don't see Jean Buddy on it, but I can see my husband was part of this crew. So. I am so grateful that I can work on these microfilms. The old papers, it's kind of fun to do this for me. The day's gone by every Monday, so I go to the library. The library has a fantastic thing. It is a microfilm reader, but it is a digital one. So you can, you know, whatever you see, you can copy off your flash drive and take it home and then use it, which is really great. I mean, it's just big help for me. Yeah.
Did you ever know Tom Anderson?
Yes, yeah.
Yes. Child,
yeah.
And one of his customers was Mr. and Mrs. Abbott, O.A. Abbott.
Yes,
well.
Yeah, yeah.
And he has some good stories to tell about
the women. Yeah, yeah. He was later also working there at the Independent, yeah. He was a good guy. I liked him. Yes?
Do
It's in the middle of the 80s when my daughter was a paper girl. I don't know.
But we had we've been publishing a morning paper for almost a week, and I got a call about noon from Roseanne Jacobson.
Yes.
She was really upset.
Oh, sure.
Oh, my. She said she didn't get a thing done every morning because she had to stop and read the newspaper, and she had to have a thing to do.
Yeah.
She said, it was an afternoon paper. She could have her work done, and then she could jig it, but she just was so upset because she just read the whole morning to read the newspaper.
Billy, how many years did you work at the Independent?
Huh?
How many years did you work there?
I worked there for 23 years and I've been retired for 17.
You're still is waiting for her, I know. She's really, yeah. Yes?
Wasn't there just 6-day-a-week delivery for some time?
Yeah, I think we did not have a Sunday paper for a while, no?
Yeah.
No, they can't afford it anymore. They have to have all the newspapers all the time, you know. They can't afford not to have it.
But I have to think about that. She was so upset because she didn't get anything done during the morning to read the newspaper.
Oh, it's a wonderful thing. You make yourself a cup of coffee and you take the paper and you sit down.
Yeah.
If you're retired. It's a nice thing.
I don't mean that it was only delivered 6 out of 7. I think it was only published 6 days.
Yes. I think we did not have in the 40s or 50s, we did not have a Sunday paper. Yeah. Is there any other question? You want to say something?
Did he own any more than the one building?
Hedde? Yeah. When he came, he had the road ranch. If you go across from the Hall County Park, that land now is all used, not all used, but there is this settlement of nice houses and lakes and whatever. But you go a little bit further west, that whole land, he had 160 acres on that piece of land. And there was a road ranch, and I suspect, I'm not sure, but there is a map in the files in the Lincoln, in the State Historical Society, where he has a drawing. He made a drawing where he wanted a post office there. And, you know, we had a post office here, but he wanted one there too for him. And when he moved to town and sold this land, he sent it to Mr. Ewald, and I think the family is still sitting on that piece of land today. This old house looks so much like a house from Holstein. It's a nice house on the corner there. He went, then here he had a house on 3rd, let me see, 3rd and Eddy, I think. There's an old house which is a little run down today that I think he owned and lived there. And then he built that big one. And as I said, it was a business thing. You were supposed to rent it to doctors, there were doctors' offices in it. I'm glad it's bought again and somebody is going to renovate it and do something with this building, I hope, if we get some money together. Yes, that brick building, which is today a parking lot, I think, or something like that, the parking garage, or the Equitable building, I'm not sure which one it is. That's where it was, and that's where my husband went to get his papers.